Right, good morning. At least people here are awake. So I've been told that functional programmers don't wake up early in the morning. This is too, like, this is midnight for people. But we generally prefer to start on time and finish on time so that we don't punish people who show up on time, right? So we're going to keep that tradition. As soon as Amit is back, we're going to kick it off. Just a quick introduction. So, I'm going to come back a little later, talk about some of the logistics and things like that that you need to know about the conference. But before that, we'll start with the keynote. Amit Rathore is going to be doing the keynote. Amit and I worked maybe 10 years ago at ThoughtWorks together. He's gone on to do some pretty interesting startups and stuff like that. So I thought it'd be a good, way to kick off the conference with him talking about, you know, how functional languages and the whole thinking process has actually helped them with their startups. And that's basically what his talk is, you know, startups and the battle of survival. So I'm just going to wait for a minute for Amit to show up and then we're going to kick it off. There he is. I already introduced you, told all the dirty secrets about you, so now the bar is very low for you to get started.
Okay.
Thank you.
Okay, so since the introduction is already over, I will skip most of it. But anyway, just since I have the slides and I can't just, you know. So a long time ago, I wrote this book and had a good time writing it and using Clojure for many years. Unfortunately, you know, the things have changed quite a bit since then. And by the way, I mean, I'm going to ramble. This presentation is going to be all over the place. And, you know, so when I'm up like at 2 a.m., 3 a.m. trying to finish a presentation, you know, there's just too much clip art on the internet. Have you ever seen that? Notice that? I mean, how do you decide which ones to use? It's just, this took me half an hour to pick, like, really distracting. Anyway, so I've been using Clojure for a long time, and been doing startups. I've had a couple of successful ones, and I'm on my third. And again, this time, it's all Clojure, and it's called Quintype, and we'll talk a little bit about that, but, it's co-founded with this guy called Raghav, who has been in the media space for a long, long time. And we are building a next-generation publishing platform. So anyway, this talk is not about that. This talk is about surviving and fighting and battles and whatnot. So let's get on that. As usual, whatever it is you got to do, the first step is always you got to first build a robot, right? And once you've done that, you basically don't need a step two. And that's really all I had to say about that. About the survival part of it. No, seriously, that's it. I'm serious. There's nothing else. I mean, you got that thing, what else do you need? I'm serious, like, you guys are like looking at me like I've got more to say. You give me 60 minutes, right? Anyway, so what is a startup, right? It's many things, but it's certainly a roller coaster ride. But let's talk about what defines an organization to be a startup, right? It's pretty much where the solution that you're trying to look for is not an obvious solution. It's something new. Often, in fact, the problem itself is undefined. You know, it's sort of a space where you think innovation is sort of needed, and you kind of try to go in there and do something. And, you know, it's typically a super high-risk proposition. Success is definitely not guaranteed. You know, most startups, in fact, fail. But there are a few things which also define startups that are not just about the solution space or the problem space. And that is the idea of growth. The growth being that, you know, startups are typically, you know, rapidly expanding entities, whether it's business side, team size, you know, code base, whatever. And more than anything else, it's a state of mind as well, right? So there are five-year-old startups, some 10-year-old companies that behave like startups, and some, you know, two-year-old companies that don't behave like startups. So it's definitely a state of mind as well. But in no particular order, let's talk about, you know, a few things that you need to do when you do launch a startup. You know, you're talking about figuring out the domain, because typically, you know, the startup founders are not necessarily all, you know, very intimately aware of the intricacies of the actual problem space or the domain. So you got to understand that. You got to understand the various business processes that you're trying to get in there and model. Understand the goals of the potential customers. And this is important. This is different from, you know, business processes, because goals are the actual desired outcomes and the processes are just what they happen to be doing now. But that doesn't necessarily need to be how you build your software or your startup, right? You've got to understand the metrics that define the success of this, these desired outcomes. And your job then is to, you know, design solutions, you know, manifest these ideas and solutions as potential features. And, you know, then, you know, step two again is finding customers for whatever that you've come up with. And, you know, pretty much you might have seen this. This is the book by, from the book by Jeffrey Moore. And it talks about, it's, you know, the adoption of technology follows a predictable path. And you've got these different segments of customers. And you've got the innovators where, you know, typically when you launch a startup, you're looking to find those early adopters and innovators that are basically enthusiasts, they're champions, and they love startups and they love innovation. They love, you know, that gritty, you know, nothing quite works right, but it's kind of, you know, way ahead of what's out there and it's kind of disruptive. And, you know, there's usually a very small number of these guys out there compared to the whole market, hopefully. But you got to find these guys and, you know, build your product and get more funding or whatever. And, you know, that's the goal. And, you know, the first maybe year or two is you're going to focus exclusively on that pre-chasm space, right? So you're finding these guys. And then you can't get away with it, though, because just having people from that early segments isn't enough. You could be, you know, very successful in that first couple of years. And, you know, it's a roller coaster ride. You're on that high. And often that high can be, a, you know, a cliff. Right? Because if you don't figure out a way to get over that safely, then that's that. Right? So the question of, you know, people talk a lot about lean startups and things like that and talk about product market fit. And, you know, product market fit, what does that actually mean, right? It's about, obviously it's about finding, you know, a market for your product, but it's in a, it's not just having someone use your software is not enough. You've got to find a business model that is actually repeatable and scalable as you grow your company. And so, you know, that's a big part of that as well. And all of this, you know, as it happens, you know, is being sort of done against this countdown, you know, that that you've got a limited, you know, time, resources, money, whatever, and limited options. So these are the constraints that you're typically under, right? So startups are always under certain constraints. That is a big part of defining what a startup is. You know, if you're a big company, you may not have urgent constraints, but you'll probably have some kinds of constraints. But startups are extreme in the sense of the kind of constraints that they have to operate under. And in a startup, things become extremely clear because it's so very, you know, in your face every day. You know, in a big company or in sort of established businesses, you know, there's an ecosystem of support, there's people doing different things, and you're sort of just, you know, playing along and working with that infrastructure, and you got none of that in a startup. So everything becomes very much in your face, and it sort of changes the, you know, perspective on all these things that we're talking about. So the same thing when you're talking about in a startup is very different when you're talking about something that's not in a startup. So perspective, let's talk about that for a second, right? Taking things completely out of perspective brings the most clarity. And what that, well, first of all, let me just say I came up with that. I wanted you all to know that. So if you ever use that, you should. But, you know, it just means that, you know, when you kind of take something out of its natural ecosystem or habitat, then it's very, very obvious what that thing is, because you're not sort of seeing everything in one big picture. You're taking out one element of something and you're looking at just that. And I'm going to digress again, like Burning Man. And the reason I'm going to digress into Burning Man is because I just came back from 7 days of Burning Man. And that's why I was up all night writing these slides, because the idea was, you know, I'd have time before the, today, but of course I didn't. And so, so let me talk about Burning Man. So what is Burning Man? It's hard to describe. It's sort of an experiment in a different kind of living. It's about you know, a lot of things, but I'll just show you some pictures rather than, it's hard to really explain it. By the way, feel free to grab me later and talk a lot more about Burning Man, because that's really all I want to talk about. So, you know, people make all kinds of art and like there's a lot of fire and it's awesome. People are sort of truly in their element. They just do exactly what they want. There are no constraints of normal society. You're free to express yourself however you want, pursue the interests and share those interests with people that also have similar interests. Truly be free, that's the goal of Burning Man. Right, and it's in a desert. And it's the extreme elements of nature in your face, every day, dust storms and, you know, rains possibly and insects and scorpions and like, you know. But it's also the most incredible experience. And people are truly just sort of, you know, doing their thing. You know, whatever they, I mean, I don't know what this guy's doing, frankly, but seems pretty intense. And there's a lot of partying and music and stuff like that. But the reason I wanted to talk briefly about Burning Man is because we started talking about perspective. And, you know, out in the desert, completely cut away, there's no internet, there's no electricity, I mean, you can get a generator if you want. But, you know, it changes your perspective on things that you experience there because it's so out of the ordinary, right? And so, for example, some of the things that they espouse there, inclusiveness, I mean, nobody knows who you are. Everybody is the same. You could be a millionaire, you could be, you know, working at a grocery store, you could be, you know, a movie star or, you know, whatever. No one knows who you are and no one cares, right? So that identity is completely, you know, just who you are as a person that day in front of you. I mean, what you're saying, what you're talking, what you're doing, that's it. And this inclusiveness, we talk about inclusiveness, we talk about diversity, we talk about all these things in companies and workforces and stuff like that, but this is an extreme form of, so you take the idea of inclusiveness and you take it to Burning Man, it's extreme. That's a different perspective. The same thing with the gifting economy. There's no money involved in Burning Man. Once you're inside the desert, there is no money exchange. Everything is free and people are making stuff and sharing with each other. You can get alcohol, you can get smash, you can get have drugs, you can do whatever it is you want. It's all free. People are just giving it away to each other. And you're also giving things to other people. So the idea of being nice to your next person next to you is, again, taken out of the normal world's perspective, and it's like, that's all you do for like days on end. You know, it's pretty amazing. So for example, trash, you have this idea of, you know, leave no trace, which is that, you know, you're going to this desert, it's a pristine landscape, you don't want to leave our human trash there. So you got to take everything back with you, including water that you've used to wash your hands or, you know, clean utensils with or whatever. You got to collect the water and take it back with you. That's extreme form of being, you know, caring about the environment and making sure that, you know, you don't leave stuff around. That it's pretty amazing. So anyway, coming back to the point, the constraints. So now constraints in a startup are exactly like that. You take them out of the context of these big companies and normal, you know, workforce type things, and it's really in your face. It's very, very extreme. So like resources, resource constraints are, you know, the sort of what makes up a startup, right? You have no engineering resources, or it's never enough in an extreme sort of way, QA, product, like all of that. Obviously money is, you know, a premium. You know, you're trying to get the next round, you're trying to get customers to pay you. By the way, this, the hardest thing in the world to do is to get somebody to give you their money. You know, I mean, it's, what is up with that? Anyway, time, you know, you don't have time. You've got, you know, your countdown is, you know, you've got potential competitors, you've got the spaces heating up, you know, or, you know, your runway is running down and you're sort of, you know, so time, and you know, you have limited chances. You can't keep failing and, you know, hoping that you'll get another chance. So it's all sort of, everything's happening at the same time, and that's sort of what this, you know, describes the startups, right? So it's a search problem. When you're within all of these constraints, it's a search problem, right? So you're trying to find a solution in the search, in the solution space, right? And whatever that solution is that you're looking for, you know, you're trying to find the max. So you got to keep trying things, and you're trying to find local. You'll find a local, you know, local maxima at some point, and you'll be really happy. And then suddenly, something will happen, and you'll fall into a trough. And you know, you'll find another one. You know, a few days or a week, few weeks later. And you know, you don't even know if you're in the actual maxima. You just don't know. It's like you're just sort of exploring everything. And that's kind of what you're doing in a startup. But basically, what are you doing? You're building some stuff, product, whatever. and hoping that somebody wants it. That's what you're trying to do, trying to build something that somebody wants. And as much as the romanticization of, you know, consumer internet companies and, you know, advertising driven models where, you know, millions and millions of customers will sort of carry you and you'll have enough advertising revenue, in general, most startups need a revenue stream, right? I mean, you can't bank on, you know, on that. You know, those overnight successes, the Instagrams and the WhatsApps of the world and so on are you know, very few. If you, you count the number of startups that are created every year and the number that actually succeed in that, you know, non-linear way is, you know, is they're all outliers. You should just remove them from the stats that you look at. So, you know, you build something that somebody actually wants and at a price that someone is willing to pay, right? So these, this is critical. So you've, at least this is how I think about it. You know, I've always not believed in the, you know, just build it and they will come, or, you know, just, you know, build something for the masses and hope that you'll get, you know, 100 million people using it, and then that'll be awesome as that'll be. And by the way, the price that, you know, someone's willing to pay, hopefully, is more than what it took you to make it, right? So there's an actual, you know, profit element involved. How quaint, right? Because you know, startup valuation is, how many of you know the science of startup valuation? You can raise your hands. Good, because there is no science, right? It's just whatever, right? So, but you know, this is a traditional model. I mean, it's evaluating a startup shouldn't be any different from evaluating any business, right? I mean, P ratios and, you know, E, earnings is important. And you know, profit is important, and that's how you know VC money. You're burning VC money is not a business model, right? Oh, you can quote me on that. I should have written that down. So this idea is, you know, all of these things that you're doing is sort of you're trying to build this iterative process of, you know, figuring all this stuff out as fast as you can, because again, remember all those constraints you have, right? And you're, you know, trying out all these different things, and you know, you have to still sort of keep your product dev going, your BD going, your marketing going, your sales going, your, you know, your people are leaving, and you know, I mean, there's all this craziness happening, and you've got to do all of this every day, every minute, as fast as you can. And when things don't work, you want to know that fast, right? You want to fail quickly, learn, move on, repeat, right? That's what you want to do. And with all of this, you know, the success rates of startups are, you know, actually pretty abysmal, right? I mean, different stats on the internet, but in general, I'd say, you know, only 5% of startups actually succeed. You know, so like 19 out of 20 startups will fail. And that's kind of sobering. I mean, you know, as romantic as it all seems and exciting and everything else, the reality is most startups will actually fail. And of course, this includes startups, in not just tech startups, right? It includes new restaurants and, you know, whatever. Although I would, you know, probably a restaurant wouldn't quite qualify as a startup because of the growth. There's no growth in that same sort of scale. But, you know, the question is then, you know, if these are the stats, A, are we crazy, you know? Are we crazy to leave the, you know, security and you know, sort of comfort of you know, corporate life and or whatever else, and try this, right? No, because you know, this group of people here are, you know, obviously the smartest of you know a lot of you know, tech people, and we want to live up to our potential, which is why this seems so exciting, because we know we can do better. We know there's so much inefficiency in software and in all of these different things that we just talked about, and we think we can do better. Right, because we're smarter, right? And so the question then becomes that, okay, if that's true, but then what do we do to equip ourselves to improve this on these stats? How do we make sure that we are that 5% and not the 95%? By the way, stats is just like the desert. It is completely impersonal. It doesn't care about you, right? I mean, if you read psychology and you know, all of this stuff, everybody thinks I think that I'm different. You know, I'm unique, but I'm unique just like everyone else. And that makes me part of the stats, you know? And as much as I might dream about, you know, how it's going to be amazing and all of that. And those dreams, by the way, are important. Without those dreams, you won't have the successful endeavors. 95% of startups will fail. So just, I mean, it's an inexorable fact. So embrace it. I mean, just being, I mean, it's important for startup founders and people who work at startups to be optimistic. Crazy, perhaps. In fact, it's a requirement. But there's, you have to have that element of, you know, a little bit of that reality check every day, which is often why, you know, I like to surround myself, at least, with people that are a little bit less crazy than I am, and that who can remind me that, you know, that my reality distortion field will only, you know, go so far, and, you know, the world doesn't actually care. So, for example, Tejas here, who runs engineering at Quintab, every day tells me, you know, how crazy I am. So what can we do then to improve our success rate, right? It all boils down to leverage, right? How do we, you know, everybody knows what leverage is, right? In the financial world, it means, you know, you borrow money, and so margin, for example, is a form of leverage, where you borrow money and buy options, for example, right? And if you do well, you magnify your gains, but of course, if you do badly, you're screwed. But it's leverage. It's an example of leverage. But the traditional, you know, word, the leverage, lever, comes from this, you know, idea of the metal bar, right? This long stick, right? And better Archimedes saying this than me or anyone else, but with a big enough lever, you can move the world, right? So tools are important, right? And equipping ourselves with the best possible tools gives us a better chance of success. And, you know, we have to embrace that. And, you know, and again, this is like preaching to the choir in this room, but it's really important. By the way, the rest of that thing is, give me a lever and a place to stand and I will move the world. That's what he actually said. It's probably from physics standpoint, that's probably true. I mean, if the tensile strength of that bar is strong enough, it's probably possible, right? And if you have something there where you can actually keep that whatever the thing is, the tripod, if you can actually keep it on a celestial platform of that size, and if the tensile strength is enough, you could probably move the earth. It's probably, you know, possible. But, you know, there are other forms of leverage. And the tools are, it's all about tools. Like the bicycle was a invention that transformed humanity. I mean, suddenly we could go, you know, miles every day. We could travel far distances. We could get water. We could go and attend schools. And we could, you know, meet other people. And, you know, all of these different things became possible when we didn't have to walk everywhere, right? And this was dramatic. And we owe a lot to it, right? Which is why famously Steve Jobs one time said, you know, computers are bicycles for the mind. You know, it wasn't, you know, lightly said, because the bicycle truly was that insanely dramatic thing. And today we talk about other things. You know, we talk about multiple cores and, you know, harnessing the power of GPUs and, you know, I mean, these are all things which help us, and, you know, we need to equip ourselves with the best possible tools in this fight for survival. Because remember, it's that inexorable odds that we are up against. So there are more of these things, right? MapReduce. I mean, Google, you know, changed the world based on a few innovations, right? And as you all here know, that this particular one came from functional programming. So you know, these are the sorts of things we want to leverage. We want leverage, right? So where do we find leverage in this world of startups? We find leverage through the people we hire, right? You know, back in the day, my two startups ago, when Clojure was still in its infancy, and in fact wasn't even 1.0, it was still in Subversion. I remember we were in production with Clojure, and I remember still that, you know, as part of our build process, we would have to check out, what was it called, a tag, I think? It's pathetic, I've forgotten what these things are. Tag, I think, Subversion tag 769 or something, to build Clojure as part of our build process. But, you know, it's a risk, it's a pros and cons. You've got to evaluate, you know, yes, it's risky, no one's using it. you know, it's some guy from like, you know, Boston who's this crazy hair, and you know, he's got like one video or two videos on the net, and you know, he's talking about this new Lisp, and it's on the JVM, and it's like, you know, very functional and all this stuff. But it sounded, you know, if you look at it and you kind of, you know, and you stake your future on it. You take the chance, you take the risk. It's not very different from a corporate coming to a startup and saying, you know what, I'm going to use you, your service for this. It's the same thing. They are, you know, taking a risk by doing that. And it's really important for startup founders to remember that. You owe them a lot, because these guys are literally risking their, you know, promotions or career choices or whatever it is, the politics of the situation in these large companies, on you. So, you know, we owe it to people who push technology and, you know, push the envelope and the state of the art on newer ways of doing things. And so, you know, Clojure back in the day was the tool we picked. This was like 2008, late fall of 2008. And, you know, people, and that time at least, it became a self-selecting mechanism for us to get the bright people that we wanted to work with. Because, you know, it's a self-selecting process of people who wanted to start using Clojure back in 2008 and 9 and 10. You know, and today it's impossible to find them because they've got lots and lots of options. But back in the day, it was great. It was a competitive advantage for us, you know, that, you know, there was actually a startup that was, you know, right in the middle of the Bay Area, you know, using Clojure, you know, in production, and, you know, believed in that sort of dynamic, you know, language and, you know, Lisp and that whole approach to building software and all of that. And so we got the best and brightest people to join us. And people, by the way, all these things I'm going to talk about, they all compound, because each of these things feed into the other. So, you know, the whole idea of non-linearity, I mean, I'm sure in this room at least, we all know that a good programmer, or a very good programmer, and compared to an average programmer, is like, I don't know, 10x better, 20x, 30x better, I mean, right? It's not a joke. People don't, it's really true. I mean, I've worked with people that are just like, by themselves, literally can, you know, bang out entire, you know, solutions and save the company. I mean, it's happened. It's been done. You know, I've seen it happen. And so, you know, this is a critical thing. This is, and you know, people of course make or break any company. But this is, again, remember perspective. And instead of a startup in the desert, if you have the wrong people, you're dead. Right? And the same thing holds true in startups. If you're lost in the desert and you're sort of, you know, whatever, like, you know, hanging out with the people who just are just like, yeah, whatever, and you know, you're just gonna get eaten by vultures. Right? Eventually. And so, same thing. The other things, so people are a form of leverage. Processes are a form of leverage, right? You certainly would not, you know, catch anyone in this room saying, you know, I'm going to, like, approach this problem with the waterfall method, right? I'm going to analyze the problem domain, and I'm going to figure out the requirements, and I'm going to write them down now so that, you know, 2 years from now, we'll have everything ready or whatever, right? So obviously, we're going to use the best process that makes sense, and you know, whether it's whatever name you give it, I mean, you know, is immaterial. But it's about being agile, for example, and not doing agile and all of that stuff and lean and all these other things. So this is another form of leverage, and you compound this with the smartest people and these agile processes, and you get, you know, twice the bang for the buck, right? And you know, how do you think about things, and how do you approach product design, and you know, what is your philosophy to building systems and all of that, is another form of leverage, right? I mean, you could, and we'll talk about that a little bit as well, but you know, these are all things which sort of feed on into each other. It's like a virtuous cycle that gets going when you do all of these things that gives you a better chance for success. And the same thing, you know, when we went from OO to functional programming was a similar step in that leveraged direction, right? So let's talk about objects really, really briefly. And let's spend the next 20 minutes going through this diagram. Since this is obviously really important. Let's not. So this guy said this, and you know, we all know, I mean, in this room I hardly need to, again, you know, talk about this a whole lot, but, you know, OO and objects are about nouns, right? I mean, we talk a lot about, you know, the various, you know, domain objects, and we you know, when we start to design, okay, what are all the names, and you start to throw them up on the board, and that's where, you know, we start, and all these processes that we're talking about, these things that need to happen are owned by these norms, right? The whole idea of designing an OO system is about, you know, responsibility allocation, right? Back in the day, if you read those GRASP patterns and things like that, what does GRASP stand for? General Responsibility Allocation Software Patterns. Wow, actually, I remember that. But anyway, point being that this is that design idea is all about, you know, figuring out which noun should own which process, and you know, that's, you know, not that that gives you low coupling and, you know, cohesive designs and all of that other stuff. But there were problems, obviously, right? But anyway, in this world, the nouns eventually become classes, and, you know, the processes we're talking about becomes the methods on those classes, and it's all good. But you run into that wall, which we all know, which is why we kind of moved on from there, right? And this wall is often manifested in a statement that goes something like this, right? Because it's not everything is an object, right? And other problems too, like mutating. How do you safely mutate state, particularly in the new world today of like multi-core and lots of, you know, competing, you know, processes going on and all of that? How do you safely do all of that? And so, and again, remember this. By the way, state mutation is nothing new. I mean, there's always state, and there's always mutation. It's a question of safe mutation. And this, again, perspective changes when you take, you know, when you have the old, like 20 years ago, you had one CPU and one process going on. It's not a big deal, because there is no chance of doing unsafe mutation. But when you take it into the desert of, like, you know, a one processor having two, or a graphics card having 256 cores, and you're harnessing that and you're trying to mutate something, that's an extreme problem, right? And you know, so that's this. So again, this is what happens, right? So this brings us to functional programming, right? And where the verbs are it's a kingdom of verbs now. It's not a kingdom of nouns. And verbs are the processes, as we know. And now it becomes a question of modeling these business processes, and not just modeling the domain in general. By the way, domain is not a bad word. Domain is a great word, because it's really important to understand your domain and to model that right, whether you do it in O or in functions or whatever. But in this world, nouns are data, not, you know, entities that own state or own processes or whatever. They're just data structures, often immutable. And the verbs transform these nouns, right? In other words, functions transform these data structures, and they do things. And in this world, you know, things like purity of this, you know, function space, what's impacting your external state, your mutable state, what's just transforming functions, what's support functions, what's a service interface, all these things become very clear. And if you design this stuff properly, then you can have a fairly pure system which gives you a lot of benefits, and we'll get to that, like testing and deployments and scaling and, you know, all of that stuff, right? But it gives you a lot of clarity as well. Because now you know very clearly what's happening where, and what function is doing what, and things like that, without thinking about, oh, you know, something got mutated somewhere, and, you know, I mean, this is nothing new here. But it gives you a lot of stuff. It gives you maintainable code, right? and again, as I just talked about, I mean, domain is important. It's not an OO word, by the way. The domain-driven design, the book, Eric Evans' book, is very much applicable in this world. Because, you know, if you've ever done a non-trivial functional system with, you know, hundreds of thousands of lines of code, you can make a big ball of mud in any language, right? I mean, you can do it in Clojure, in Scala, or any other language so these principles very much apply. And so, you know, over the years that we've learned, at least, that this stuff that we've learned in the OO world translates really, really well, right? I mean, in this world here, for example, domain functions are all pure functions that simply transform data that comes in, and it sends the data out into, let's say, persistence layers or something else that stores it in some sort of database service or data storage service, and, you know, something on above the domain model that transports this into through an API, HTTP interface, or, you know, to whatever FTP, whatever it is, and then something shows this stuff to somebody. This stuff that we've learned in the OO world is great, and it applies very well. But when you design stuff this way, you know, you're getting a lot of benefits, right? We're getting testability, because you can write all the tests you want at the domain function level without having to worry about anything else at all, like no state worries, no nothing. You can do fuzz testing, you can do generative testing, you can do you know, all this automated stuff that, you know, it makes it much harder to do in the OO world, right? Because of just
the way how much setup you need. You don't need setup. It's a function. You send it, you create whatever data you want and call it. You know, so there's no like complicated setup in your tests and things like that, teardowns and then making sure that the database gets rolled back and all that other stuff. I mean, it's just non-existent if you do it right, which is really great. It gives you speed. It gives you, you get to go faster. It gives you scalability because, you know, once you've got these clean boundaries and these pure functions and stuff like that, it's not a very far stretch to say, you know, that you can start thinking about functions as services, right? In the end, it's something that takes in data and gives you some transformed result. And you can start to model bits and pieces of these functions out into your own microservices as you grow and as you figure out where the load in your system is and so on and so forth. And by the way, these things which have the term microservices bandied about like crazy everywhere, but is very natural in the functional world because, you know, microservices are essentially functions. And, you know, this gives you the ability to scale your teams because now you've got services that are owned by people within your team, in your larger group, and it's a good way to, you know, not have everybody working on this giant monolithic code base, right? It's a very easy way to have separate deployments for different bits of your architecture and grow teams like that. And you've got other benefits, like we just talked about, immutability. You know, we know about immutable data and the benefits from that. And now there are, you know, immutable databases too, which you can leverage. Datomic comes to mind. There are others, I'm sure. And so, you know, these ideas also apply to things beyond just the microcode level stuff. For example, infrastructure. Like if you're on AWS or cloud-based deployments and stuff like that, you know, the RedBlue deploys exactly that. It's an immutable deploy system, right? You create an immutable instance of, you know, a bunch of servers that run certain things, and when you want to do a new upgrade, new push, that stuff goes away and new stuff comes up, right? It's exactly what immutable data structures teach us, right? There's more benefits, obviously, as we all know. Composability, right? When you start thinking like this, when you start thinking about functions and microservices and APIs and, you know, well-designed bits and pieces, then, you know, you can start selling bits of the system. That becomes an option. You build a giant monolithic code base and you've got one thing to sell, whatever that thing is doing. But if you've got like 20 things that are components, you can start to think about selling components. And I'll talk a little bit about, you know, what we're doing at Quintype here, just to give you some example of what I mean by this is, you know, in the publishing world, there's just so many pieces that you need to do to run your media operation. You know, you got to start with everything you need to create content, so CMS and stuff like that. You've got pushing that stuff out into apps, into websites, you know, iOS app, TVOS app now, and, you know, Apple Watch, and like all these different things. You've got audience management in analytics, you know, recommendation systems. You've got, you know, Google SEO, SEM management. You've got, you know, email marketing systems, push notification engagement things. You've got, I mean, the list just goes on. Then monetization, advertising, programmatic real-time bidding stuff. You've got e-commerce pieces. You've got, you know, native content matching, you know, between who should be shown what, data collection, real-time everything. You know, there's just like 20 different things you need to run a media operation. And so today's landscape is this fragmented, you know, you've got vendor central, you know, it's all like bits and pieces everywhere. You've got to like pick and choose and manually integrate. It's just it's a giant mess. So when we're building Quintype, which is a sort of seamless end-to-end, all these different modules, well integrated, you know, just does a little bit of whatever is really needed and all the bloatware goes away and all of that. We could build that as a single monolithic system, right? Everything has been done as a giant, but instead, when we built it as the way we built it, we are now able to sell an advanced analytics service. We're able to sell an advanced personalization service for media. We're able to sell, you know, bits and pieces, like appification. Like you one click, being able to generate apps, iOS apps and, you know, Android apps and, you know, Apple Watch apps and Gear apps and now TV apps and stuff like that, by the click of a button, that's by itself a little very nice thing which nobody else has, and we can sell that because we built it as a separate piece, right? And it's all very nicely, so this is a competitive advantage. This is a, you know, you can, because you don't know what's going to work. You build this giant monolithic thing and nobody wants to pay for it, now you're screwed. But now suddenly, you know, how do you hear about these pivots, right? You hear about startups pivoting and stuff like that. How does it happen? They realize, oh my God, like somebody is really interested in this one thing. They built 20 things and someone's really interested in this one thing. But if you didn't build that 20 things and had that one thing, you wouldn't know about it. And then, you know, you can't pivot to that. So this is an important part of that. So this is, and this is not very different from selling APIs, right? So you build everything in a set of APIs, and you know, but it's the question of modeling it right from the beginning to think like this. And you can then, you know, also create new bits from these existing bits, right? You combine the composability and the combinatorial explosion of possibilities is another competitive advantage. And even if it's not so much at the API level, it's certainly true at the function level and at the code level. And this, of course, brings me to the idea of bottom-up design, right? Which is, you know, as opposed to top-down design. Again, I'm sure this is not new to you guys, but top-down design being, you know, oh, okay, let me think. I've got, you know, this problem space in, say, digital publishing or whatever, and I'm going to build a system to solve the problem as I see it today. And I'm going to say, okay, this has 5 modules, and the 5 modules have these different components, and I'm going to go ahead and build. That's top-down. I'm thinking about the solution, and I'm building down to whatever I need to create that. But bottom up is, I actually don't care about the end solution. I actually want to model the domain. There's like, oh, so there's analytics. Okay, there's data collection, and there's content, and there's, you know, whatever. Like there's, you know, users, and there's social media, and there's, you know, these different things. And I'm just going to blindly model these in my domain, you know, without thinking about how the end solution is going to look. And I'm going to create these functions and these, you know, services that sort of, you know, model this stuff, represent the knowledge inside it, the processes that you need, and you know, then you're going to have all this available to you, and then you can now pick and choose and combine what's needed to kind of go upwards to a solution that you can present to a user. But the point is that now you have all these. It's like first building Lego. First you build the blocks, and then you put it together to do whatever you need to, and then you can change it if it doesn't work very quickly, as opposed to, you know, building a blueprint for the entire house and then building the pieces down. Now you've got pieces, but they only fit in one way, and they build this house that you designed. But that wasn't the house they wanted, right? So this lets you, you know, solve an entire class of problems in this domain space. Because you don't know what you're solving. I mean, in the startup world, you have some idea, but you really have no idea, right? That's what it means. Having some idea means you have no idea, right? And that's, you better embrace that. And you got to embrace that in a very specific way, which is you got to put your money where your mouth is and don't pretend like you know it. You got to behave like you don't know it and plan for that. And this gives you a really great way to do that. So, you know, you model the domain and you then build up these levels of abstraction, right? And this, again, makes it easier, like I said, to find the solution that we're all looking for in this space. Particularly good with chaotic requirements. If you're not in a startup world, but requirements are changing a lot, how else will you manage that, right? You can't keep going back and redoing the blueprint every time. You'd rather just rejig the pieces, right? Or if you're in a startup, like I said, right? And this brings us to, for example, DSLs, right? Like the whole idea that now that you've got these building blocks and these layers of abstraction, you can actually put a language on top of some of this stuff, and, you know, certain, like Clojure, for example, it's a Lisp, so that's a first-class thing, and I'm sure others do it. And, you know, give you this idea of these little languages that different people in your world, whether it's customers themselves or whether it's, you know, your salespeople or your integration people or your account managers or your whoever, can quickly work with your system in a very specific way, rather than going to developers every time or whatever that process is. Now they can quickly, you know, scripting. You're basically building a scriptable system. This is what you need because of the nature of this sort of changing, moving, shifting landscape in this world. Incredible flexibility. I mean, if you can script stuff, then you cut that loop down, right? If you don't have to go down to the bare metal every single time, and you can just quickly operate at this high level, that's great, right? You can quickly, you know, bang out features. And combinatorial explosion, by the way, every time you add one new capability down here, it's combinatorially now available for to mix with everything else that's already there, right? So it's amazing. It gives you not just, you know, lots of flexibility, but it gives you dynamic flexibility, because oftentimes this is all at runtime, right? You don't even have to do a deploy. It just works. Eval, right? I mean, people hate eval. Eval is like, oh my God, like, you know, you can just like run whatever code, you know? And it's pros and cons. It's the same risk benefit equation. I mean, back in the day, you could literally do an eval in the live system, which would change prices of all your products across the board. And you could say potentially that, you know, you're going to just get bankrupt by like somebody making a mistake. Yeah, okay, that never happened. number one. And so if we had decided not to do it because it might have happened, we would have lost all that flexibility. Right? So the tool is there. And of course, you can add some guard clauses and this and that, but embrace it. Right? The power is there. Again, functional programming gives you concurrency. We talked about that. You know, lots of cores, et cetera, mutable state, managing all of that. So that's what I wanted to talk about leverage, right? About the tool set and the language and what it affords us. So again, coming back to this, I'm wrapping up now, so I'm getting close to, you don't have to listen to me forever. best people for the job, right? I mean, do you know what SEAL Team 6 is? SEAL Team 6, by the way, I could have not blacked out these faces, but then I would have to kill you all. These guys are the you got to read books on these guys. I mean, these are mental. I mean, these guys are crazy. You know, and the point is that, you know, they also use the best tools, right? I mean, I don't know if you're into guns and stuff. I'm not, but I just wanted to do some research for this presentation, and it was like 3 a.m., so what else are you going to do? And actually, to be really honest, it's about whether you take anything away from this or not. This gun, by the way, is the one you want to use when you're playing, Call of Duty, because you will win. But against the Goliaths of the world, you know, the startup fight against these big corporations, big entrenched processes, whatever it is that you're trying to change, whatever you're trying to disrupt, you don't send in the infantry. It's just not going to work. A, you don't have infantry. You don't have like 500 people or 1,000 people. But even if you do send it, I mean, if you're going to try and take down Amazon in some aspect, you're not going to like beat them on brute force, right? You're not going to like take Flipkart, and say, you know what, I'm going to like just overwhelm you with numbers. Right? It's not going to happen, right? So don't send in the infantry when only the SEAL team will do, right? And the SEAL team is in this room, right? Because these are like the elite units that are going to make every single person is going to be that 20x, 30x, 50x compared to the average So that's what you get when you get the best of the best, right? It's like the Spartans, right? It's like the Spartans. I just wanted to put the Spartans picture, actually. It's pretty awesome. And those who know the story, just shut up. Right? But that's okay. I mean, it's like, it's the who cares if we die? Huh? Everyone's going to die. Who doesn't die? Is anybody not planning not to die? This is the picture I really wanted to put. So I put both. The tools, the people, right, the processes. So that's really what I wanted to talk about in terms of leverage. How do you survive? Think. Embrace the flaws and the weaknesses of what the startup is and what you're trying to do and all of that. So I'll just briefly wrap this up. Why am I doing this again this time? Third startup, third functional programming team. We're again staking our future on this, and we'll probably try out, we'll learn a lot about newer functional programming techniques in this conference and other places, and we're going to try out, whatever's the right tool for the job, not just closure, right? And we're trying to change a world, what we're doing at Quintype, we're trying to change a world where, everything is controlled by corporate media. I mean, how many of you have realized that, all the news outlets are basically controlled by, five entities in the world, or whatever, 5 or 10 or whatever, right? I mean, it's, you know where this is from? This is like the Big Brother. I mean, everybody is just getting fed the same processed information, right? And that's not how you are going to be free. You can't be free if you don't know the truth and if you're brainwashed, essentially. And corporate media is it's vested interests, political interests, whatever it is the whole media, industry is, is this getting recorded? It is. I won't say anything. It's great. It's perfect. Just read everything you see online, and it's awesome. But we are powerless even to know the real story, because they don't want you to know. You know why LSD was banned in the US? Because people started to think and started to question. There's nothing wrong with LSD. The guy who invented LSD did it every day, lived up to be like 97 years old, right? And he was, perfectly fine, and he had no Alzheimer's and like all that other stuff. So they banned it because they didn't want people. That's what it is. That's the world we live in. And if you're not aware of that, wake up, right? Because this is who we've become. We're just sitting there, like, you know, just getting fed, you know, like mushrooms, right? Getting fed, kept in the dark and getting fed bullshit, right? So that's what we're trying to change. We want to change that and, you know, sort of one media company at a time. You know, we want to make independent media possible. Because today, where's the source of truth? It's bloggers, it's Twitter, right? People who are not controlled by, you know, they just say whatever they want. And then, of course, there's huge amounts of noise, but that's the price we pay, and that's okay. But at least there's some level of truth out there, right? So that's what we want to encourage, the rise of independent voices, so we can all wake up from the, you know, from the matrix, essentially. That's really what's happening. I mean, if you go deep, this is pretty scary stuff. And freedom only will come when we actually know what's going on. We get to choose what we, how we react. Because right now, we're all on autopilot. And so the question is, who's going to usher in this new renaissance? Who's going to make it possible for these, you know, free thinkers and speakers to actually thrive, and independent media to actually thrive and be real and plentiful? How's that going to happen, right? Who's going to simplify the landscape? I talked to you earlier about all the different pieces you need to run a media company. I mean, back in the, like, you know, maybe 15 years ago, before Blogger or Blogspot or whatever it was called, you know, it was not that hard to start a blog. I mean, what is it? HTML and hosting it somewhere. But that alone enough was sufficient to have basically nobody do it, right? And when Blogger came out, it was one click and, you know, you get a blog, you know, and that's up and running. We all know what happened. There's like everybody has a blog. So who's going to simplify this landscape, right? I mean, this landscape is nuts. There's like thousands of things that you've got to do to just get something off the ground. And by the way, if you're not making money in the media space, you're going to die. So it's a very real thing. It's not just about, you know, philanthropy and just helping you, you know, it's important, that's important, but you need to be able to run a business. So when you think about starting a media company and so on, you need to think about all the different pieces you need to run and making money and all of that and being a viable, self-sustaining business, right? So who's going to take all this craziness and simplify it? Who's going to be the Apple of the next digital media platform, right? And how are we going to do this? This is a very entrenched space with like thousands of players, and it's complicated, and it's just not been innovated in and all of that, right? So our question is, at what we're trying to do and why we're going to pick functional programming again, is that can we make this as easy as blogging? Can we make all of this complexity go away and just make it work, right? That's the challenge, right? All these moving parts and, you know, the complexity, the change that's happening on a constant basis. I mean, TVOS came out. How many media companies are going to jump on that bandwagon? And if you're starting a new one today, how long is it going to take you to build a, you know, TVOS app? I mean, that's like, you're not even going to think about it, right? And the problem is that, you know, if something that new that you're offering isn't like 10x better, by the way, this is another startup thing, right? If it's not an order of magnitude better, it's just not worth it for them to change and take the risk. Anyone, right? I mean, if something is like double better, you say, yeah, it's like cost to make the change and like your comfort zone and learning and, you know, hoping it works. And it's got to be like it's got to be a lot better, right? So the question then we are facing at Quintype is, how do we do all of this complex stuff? How do we make it 10x better, do it in the same constraints we talked about, right? Change the world, right? How do we do all of this stuff, right? And again, the 80-20 rule applies, right? Just do the 20% stuff that gives you 80% of the value. So don't build the bloatware. If you want analytics, don't use Omniture, right? Use what we're building, small things, small pieces. Building the integrated components, the little things I talked about. Those, you know, that's kind of the landscape that we're building here, right? So that's what I'm trying to say. I mean, this thing is, all of these things, the modules for all of this, I mean, monetize each of these things, there are companies in the space today. Ad tech is a huge space by itself. And, you know, whatever, pick your thing, email marketing, companies. So it's a very ambitious idea. The roadmap at Quintype is extraordinarily ambitious. And I'm, you know, admitting that, right? But I think it's possible if we do this right, if we take a different approach. And people in this room, for example, are perfect for that, right? It's perfect for a crack team of functional programmers, right? The SEAL Team 6 of programming. That's kind of what we're going to go in with, right? So that's really what I wanted to say. This is why we are sort of here and so on. But, you know, really the real reason why you want to use functional programming is because it's badass. And here's the man burning. It's a 70-foot tall, you know, structure that goes on fire on the last day, and it's amazing. It's pretty badass, just like functional programming and startups and the G36. in Call of Duty, for sure. So that's basically it. We have a few minutes for questions. And I just wanted to say also that the party that we had yesterday in the Quintype hotel room continues today. Lots more alcohol, so come over. Some of you were there. We had a good time, and which is also why the slides only got done this morning. But hopefully it worked out, and you guys took something, will take something from this. But yeah, open for questions for a couple minutes, if there are any. Well, it's easy to find me, and room 330, if you want to come by, have a drink, and then ask the question, that's fine too. It's easier for me to answer it as well. So thank you, everyone.